human sensory organs, ears, nose, and tongue. Ears are the sense organs for hearing. The human ear mainly consists of three main parts: the external ear, the middle ear, and the internal ear. The external and middle ear are exclusively concerned with hearing. The internal ear has a cochlear part concerned with hearing and a vestibular part meant for maintenance of equilibrium and posture. The external ear consists of an immovable cartilaginous pinna and an external auditory canal leading inwards. The pinna collects and directs sound waves into the external auditory canal. The passageway of the auditory canal is an obstacle course of hairs and wax-producing glands that catch insects, dust, etc. It also helps to moderate the climate inside the ears. The external auditory canal ends at a delicate, whitish, glistening, membranous diaphragm called tympanic membrane. The middle ear is an air-filled chamber on the other side of the tympanic membrane and inside the cranial bone. An eustachian tube emerges from the middle ear and opens into the nasopharynx. It helps in maintaining the balance in air pressure between the two sides of tympanic membrane. The middle ear cavity contains three small pieces of bone, namely malleus or hammer, hincus or anvil, and stapes or stirrup. These are called ossicles. Auditory ossicles transmit the sound-induced vibrations of tympanic membrane to the fluid endolymph, which fills the internal ear. The internal ear is in the form of a complex system of cavities and is also called labyrinth. It has two organs, namely vestibular apparatus and cochlea. Vestibular apparatus is situated in posterior to the cochlea. It is meant for maintenance of equilibrium and posture and is therefore called a sense organ for balancing. Cochlea is meant for hearing. The bony structure of the internal ear is known as bony labyrinth. A membranous sac is called membranous labyrinth and is present within the bony labyrinth. It contains fluid known as endolymph. Both vestibular apparatus and cochlea are situated within the membranous labyrinth. There is a fluid present between the bony labyrinth and membranous labyrinth known as sperilymph. Vestibular apparatus consists of three semicircular canals: superior, posterior, and lateral or horizontal, and two sacs, namely the utricle and the saccule. They are located in the membranous labyrinth. The three semicircular canals open into the utricle. Each canal is dilated at the opening, and this dilation is known as ampulla. The utricle communicates with the saccule via a duct, and in turn, the saccule communicates with the cochlea. Cochlea has a snail-like appearance. It is a coiled bony tube with 2 to 3/4 turns. There are two membranes, Reisner's membrane and basilar membrane, which divides the canal of the cochlea into three cavities known as scala vestibuli, scala media, and scala tympani. Scala vestibuli lies on top of Reisner's membrane, and it contains the fluid called perilymph. Scala media is present between the Reisner's membrane and basilar membrane, and it contains endolymph. Scala tympani lies below the basilar membrane, and it is also filled with perilymph. The organ of Corti rests on the basilar membrane and extends in a spiral manner to the turns of the cochlea. It has several rows of hair cells all along its coil course, which serve as auditory receptors. The ear pinna collects and directs the sound waves traveling through air into the external auditory canal. The sound waves create vibrations in tympanic membrane or eardrum. These vibrations are transmitted to the chain of ossicles to the perilymph in the vestibule. With each tiny inward movement of the membrane, the malleus next to it vibrates in the same rhythm and by a lever action transmits the message to the adjoining incus, and the incus in turn transmits the vibrations to the stapes. The stapes bone relays the vibration to the inner ear. The movement of stapes towards the vestibule sets up a pressure wave in the perilymph. This wave passes from the vestibule into the scalar vestibuli and travels through it to the apex of the cochlea.
At this point, scalar vestibuli is continuous with scalar tympani.
The pressure waves pass into scalar tympani and again transverse the whole length of cochlea.
In this way, vibrations are set up in the perilymph and through it in the basilar membrane. The basilar membrane moves up and down, distorting hair cells, which in turn generate nerve impulses that travel through cochlear nerve to the appropriate part of the brain where the sound perception of the subject is produced. The ear contains not only receptors sensitive to sound in the cochlea, but also receptors sensitive to movement and gravity in other areas of the inner ear. They are helpful for our sense of balance and coordination. The sacculus and utriculus are the organs involved in the perception of gravitational fields.
Both these organs are filled with endolymph like the cochlea.
There is a bulge called macula containing receptor cells. These cells have sensory projections embedded in the otoliths. When the head is upright, there is no pull on the sensory projections, but as the head tilts in one direction, the otoliths move away from the macula under the influence of gravity.
Movements of the head in any direction can be detected by the semicircular canals, which are filled with endolymph and have a swelling called the ampulla.
Inside the ampulla is a mound of receptor cells known as crista, and these have sensory projections embedded in a jelly-like structure called the cupula. When we turn our head, the semicircular canals move with us. The movement of the cupula is opposed by the inertia of the endolymph and results in distortion of the cupula and a strain on the sensory projections. This pull sets up generator potentials in the receptor cells on one side of the ampulla, followed by action potentials in the sensory nerves, giving the brain information as to which direction the head is turning.
The human nose is also known as the organ of olfaction.
The fundamental area of smelling in the nasal mucous membrane is called olfactory area. It is brownish yellow in color. The general lining epithelium of the olfactory area is pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium. Olfactory receptor cells are present within the columnar epithelium, which carry the impulse of smell to the brain. There are 10 to 20 million receptor cells in both the nostrils of a man. They are actually a part of the primary olfactory neuron. Receptor cells are surrounded by the several sustentacular or supporting cells. The most peripheral part of the receptor cell is called the olfactory rod. Molecules emanating from the odorant substance are carried by air to the olfactory area and get dissolved in the mucus. In solution, they come in contact with the cilia of receptor cells, and as a result, a receptor potential develops. Finally, through the olfactory nerve, the impulse reaches an appropriate part of the brain and the perception of smell sense occurs. Taste buds are the sense organs for taste sensation. They occur mainly in the mucous membrane over tiny projections called papillae on the surface of the tongue. Each papilla contains several taste buds. Some taste buds are also located in the mucous membrane of the pharynx, palate, and epiglottis. Circumvallate papillae are the largest and circular. They form an inverted V-shaped row at the posterior portion of the tongue. All of them contain taste buds. Fungiform papillae are knob-like elevations over the entire surface of the tongue. Most of them contain taste buds. Filiform papillae are pointed, thread-like structures and are also distributed over the entire surface of the tongue. They rarely contain taste buds. A taste bud is an oval, barrel-shaped structure opening on the tongue's surface through a pore called taste pore. It contains 60 to 70 spindle-shaped cells, namely sustentacular cells and taste receptor cells. Taste receptor cells receive taste sensations. Some hair-like processes, known as microvilli, project out of the pore. Substances dissolved in the salivary water flow into the taste bud through the taste pore to reach receptor cells. The receptor cells are thus stimulated, and in turn, the nerve fibers which emerge from the taste buds are also stimulated and eventually reach an appropriate part of the brain to bring about the sense of taste. There are numerous varieties of taste senses, but human beings can generally recognize the four basic tastes: salty, sweet, sour, and bitter. The taste of a substance depends upon structure, function, and interrelationship of molecules. There is no structural difference between taste buds in different areas of the tongue. They differ in the sensitivity to different basic tastes. The tip of the tongue is very sensitive to sweet taste, the back to bitter, and sides to sour and salty tastes. The mid-dorsum of the tongue is insensitive to taste. A baby has many more taste buds than an adult. Some mammals, like monkeys and cats, also possess taste buds for distilled water. Adaptation of taste sensation is very quick. To conclude, we can say that the major sensory organs of the body, such as eyes, ears, nose, and tongue, play a crucial role in our life, which would not be the same in their absence.